Time for another board game review, and this time we have the game Blue Moon City. This was sent to me by CMON Games, and it's designed by Reiner Knizia. In Blue Moon City, you must move across the modular tile board and use contributions from the eight peoples of Blue Moon to rebuild the city's buildings. Players that help in the restoration of buildings will be granted rewards for their efforts. Contribute to a building in the presence of one of the mighty dragons and receive valuable tokens of their appreciation. Collect cards, tokens, valuable crystals, and make the holy offerings needed to become the next leader of Blue Moon City. Let me show you how to play. So in Blue Moon City, you are trying to make offerings before everybody else. In order to make offerings, you make contributions to buildings throughout the city to reconstruct them, which will then let you earn crystals and dragon scales and stuff, and that'll let you save up crystals to build offerings for the obelisk, which is over here. Overall, the board looks like this. It is a set of tiles, and let me just sort of get into how to play. Each player starts with eight cards. I'll go into what all the cards mean later, but on your turn, you can do the following phases in order. You can move, contribute, reset, and then pass. So, first off, let's say I was the pink player here. I can move up to two spaces orthogonally, not diagonally. Moving is optional, you don't have to, but you probably will want to if you want to start, you know, making progress in the game. So let's say I go 1, 2. That could be my movement. During your movement phase, you can also discard cards if you want to use their powers. We'll get into the powers later. Now, once you're done moving, you can choose to contribute to the reconstruction of the building on which you end your movement. If you decided not to move, like let's say you started on this space and just stayed here, you could still contribute to the reconstruction on the one you're currently on. If you end your movement on the courtyard, which is this tile in the middle, you may make an offering for the obelisk. But let's go over contributions to buildings first. To contribute to a building's reconstruction, you must discard from your hand any number of cards that have a total value equal to or greater than one of the contribution spaces. All the cards must match the space's color. So let me show you. So let's say I discard a 3 and a 1 of yellow. That means I can put a marker on this 4. That contribution will no longer be available for any other players. Now, you only have a certain number of these markers in the game, and if you don't have any at the time, you can't make a contribution. Now, you may do more than one contribution at a time. Like, let's say this player also discards a 2 as another action. They can do 2 contributions. However, you may not use leftover values from like other cards on the previous one to pay for the other one. They're all separate individual contributions. Also, when you discard these cards to use them for contributions, you cannot activate their powers. After you've done your contributions, then you may discard up to 2 cards from your hand you don't want, then draw 2 more cards than the number you discarded. So you're always gonna draw at least 2 cards, but if I discard, let's say, these 2 cards, I would draw 4 cards then. Then that's the end of your turn. You pass your turn to the next player. Now, the reason why you're putting these markers on here is once they're fully reconstructed, you will score them. So let's say the blue player moves here and also contributes. Now all 3 slots are full. So let's take a look at what this building tile looks like here. First off, this means whoever did the most contributions on this tile gets this reward. In this case, it was pink player, so they would receive a golden scale. Then each player with at least 1 marker on the building could get this reward, which is 1 crystal. So both pink and blue players, since they had contributed, they would get 1 crystal each. So once you've constructed it, you flip it over. Now this is the neighborhood bonus, and I'll explain that in a second. But let's put this on here. So now that tile has been constructed, and anyone who contributed towards it gets the rewards. Those can include crystals, which I'll get to in a second, golden scales, and cards. Getting extra cards in this game is also very useful. Now, what this neighborhood bonus means is, let's say on a future set of turns, let's say the gray player and the white player filled out this building here. In this case, the white player would get the majority bonus of 2 crystals. They would each get 2 crystals, and then this gets rebuilt. Now, what this means is, if you ever construct a building, any buildings that are already reconstructed, you all players also get that reward if they helped construct this. So in this case, both gray and white would get an additional crystal because this constructed building is already next to it. And you look at any of them that are orthogonally adjacent to it. Now let's go over golden scales. I mentioned these earlier. These are rewards you can get for either scoring reconstructed buildings or making a contribution to a building in the presence of a dragon. So let's say I was on, the red dragon was here and gray player was here. And they contributed. Now here's actually a problem with this game. That's supposed to be like, what, brown or whatever, and this is supposed to be black. That's way too similar. That is not very clear. But anyway, and so if you go on this space and let's say contributed, two, in the presence of a dragon, you receive a golden scale. Now what these golden scales do is once the last golden scale is taken from the pool, because there's only a finite number of these, they are scored. Whoever has the most golden scale tokens at that time receives 6 crystals. If there's a tie, they score 3 crystals each. Then they return their scales to the pool. Any other players who have at least 3 of these will gain 3 crystals and return them to the pool. Anyone who has fewer than 3 doesn't receive any crystals, but they keep their scales. Once this pool of scales runs out, whoever has the most scores the most crystals. There are 3 of these dragons, and I'll show you later with how you can use card powers to move them around the board. So that you can earn those golden scales. Now these crystals I keep mentioning, these are the currency we need to make offerings to the obelisk, and that's the whole objective of the game, is to make offerings towards it. Any crystals you get should be kept face down, because they can also have like 3 values on them or whatever. And as you can see on this obelisk here, there are 11 spaces in a 2-player game, or 13 spaces in a 3-to-4-player game. Obelisk spaces are filled from the bottom up using player markers. So, if I go to the courtyard on my turn and I spend 7 crystals, then I could make an offering using one of my player markers on the obelisk. The offering must be made in the courtyard and it must satisfy the required amount of crystals printed in the next available space of the obelisk, lowest to highest. If you make an offering in the presence of a dragon, you don't receive any golden scales. And unlike other buildings, you may not make 2 or more offerings to the obelisk in a single turn unless you use a particular card's special power. Now, depending on how many players you have, in a 4-player game, it's 4 offerings. Once a player makes 4 offerings in a 4-player game, it's 6 offerings for 2, 5 offerings for 3, 4 offerings for 4. They win the game. If every building tile in the city is rebuilt and no player has enough crystals to make the necessary number of offerings, you just play until everybody can make as many offerings as they can, and whoever made the most is the winner. Tie goes to the player who has the most remaining crystal. So that's all well and good, but let's get into the card powers. This is what makes the game really interesting. There are 8 different colors of cards in the game. And they each have different powers depending on how you discard them. So for example, the black cards here, these move the red dragon. For example, if you discard this card, you can move the red dragon to any space. And this one lets you move the dragon up to 3 spaces. So if you want to move it right to where you are and get a golden scale when you do your contributions, that's what that's for. Same thing, red cards let you move the green dragon in the same way. And blue cards let you move the blue dragon. Gray cards can help you move your player's miniature much faster. This card lets you move your piece up to 2 extra spaces. This one lets you move your piece to any space on the board. Green cards are just wild and can be used to be added onto other colors for contributions. In a similar way, these brown cards, any combination of 2 ones or 2 brown cards can be combined into a wild 3 of any color. Or white cards can be used to change the color of cards. So this card here can let you change the color of up to 4 cards into another color when making a contribution. All cards converted must be of the same color and will change to the same color. And this card here lets you change the color of 1 card when making a contribution. And then finally, the yellow cards. This one here, these are all about letting you do extra contributions to the obelisk. So if you're on the courtyard and you discard this card, you can pay 1 extra crystal to do an additional offering to the obelisk. And this one, after contributing to the obelisk, discard this card. The additional offering costs 2 crystals then. And that's pretty much it. There's also an expansion that comes with the game. These are some extra tiles with their own
special little twists on it, and you can actually do a full game with all of the tiles in a perfect grid as well. But otherwise, yeah, you're playing cards, discarding them for powers, moving around, contributing, scoring crystals, and you're racing to make offerings to the obelisk. And whoever does the required amount first wins. And that's the game.
So I really enjoyed this game. It's simple to grasp, but powers are fun, and it's a very satisfying sort of area majority control game where you're racing to fill out the offering spaces. It's a game where I think it gets more fun the longer you play it. In the beginning, it feels pretty simple because you're just going around, you know, going to the spots, discarding the cards, and claiming spots. But once they start getting constructed, you start to struggle with making sure that all your moves are maximized, right? Especially because it's harder to get around the board quicker to spaces that haven't been constructed. So it ramps up in both tension and fun, I think, in the later part of the game. And I think it's ingenious that when you do offerings to the obelisk, you have to use your markers, which means you have less markers to work with for the building contributions. Because you can technically do as many markers on as many different buildings as you want, but if they don't get fully constructed, those are just stuck there. So it forces you to not just throw those markers everywhere willy-nilly. Like I said before, I really enjoy the card powers. There's a lot of satisfaction in moving the dragons around to make sure you get the scales, going to the exact right spot, and depositing the cards in time, especially if you beat other people to it. The golden scale mechanic is fun. You know, I think it feels like its own little mini race in an already race-centric game where you want to, you know, get the majority of the scales first. So when the pool runs out, aha, I get 6 crystals, you get 3. There are enough different factors here to keep track of where it's always engaging, but it never feels overwhelming. The only thing I wish this game had is I wish there was a little bit of player interaction aside from just taking the spots. Like, there's no way to actually attack your opponents or block them, which I kind of would have liked, but it's not necessary. If you don't like games that allow you to mess with other players, this will be a good fit for you. I think it's got a great design and great card play and, you know, really elegant, simple mechanics. It's very good.